هيا على الفلاح
And fear Allah, fear the day that you will all be gathered together and brought to Allah. And then on that day every soul shall be recompensed only what it has earned, and no one shall be done any injustice. I read a book by a Christian evangelist who did his evangelical work in a predominantly Muslim country in Africa in the 1970s, trying to call people to his religion. And he said over and over again throughout the book a phrase. He said that in Islam there is no salvation. What he's saying is that in Islam there is no guaranteed salvation, based on the assumption, of course, that Jesus himself guaranteed salvation. The Quran would say tilka amaniyuhum, these are their imagined beliefs, these are their assumptions. So what is salvation in Islam? There must be salvation in Islam, because the Quran, more so than the Gospels, more so than the Torah or any previous scripture to it, focuses on that day of judgment. That is the goal of every Muslim. Muslims focus on the Akhirah, the hereafter, the day of judgment, and getting into Jannah, more so than any other people in the world. We are very much focused on that day of judgment and Naba'ul Azim, the great news. So what is salvation? On the one hand, we know that every Muslim, every human being must stand before the Creator of the worlds for judgment. We know that every single thing that a person has done of good and evil, he will see it on that day of judgment. فَمَن يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَن يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may enter a person into Jannah because of one word that he might have said, according to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know that a person might enter hellfire because of one word that he said. It's quite a frightening ordeal, is it not? Since every one of the children of Adam is sinful by day and by night, it's quite a frightening proposition. And yet, on the other hand, we read things from the Quran, things from the Ahadith, which make it seem as if forgiveness of Allah and entering into paradise is so easy, it's almost guaranteed, subhanAllah. On the other hand, we read things such as when Allah said to His Messenger, who said to us, O children of Adam, if you were to come to me with the earth full of sins, amassing from the earth to the sky, and you were to ascribe no partner to me, asking me for forgiveness, I would come to you with forgiveness equal to your sins. We hear things, we read things from the Ahadith, the sayings of the Prophet, about, for example, a man from the children of Israel who had done no good whatsoever in his life. And on his deathbed, he commands his son that when I die, his sons, he tells them, when I die, I want you to burn my body and scatter it in the four corners of the earth, some on the land and some in the sea. And this man will be resurrected by Allah on the Day of Judgment. And Allah will ask him one question, although Allah knows the answer already. He will ask him, why did you command your sons to do such a thing to you? And he will respond by saying, oh my Lord, I feared because I had done nothing good in my life. I feared that you would bring me forth for judgment and punish me. And the hadith ends by saying, it is not long until this man enters Jannah. We read in the Ahadith the mentioning of two men on the Day of Judgment for whom Allah will command them to enter the hellfire. And one of them goes walking to the hellfire, and then he stops and looks back. And then he goes walking to the hell, and he stops and looks back. And the other one goes running towards hellfire as fast as he can. He goes running towards the hellfire. And so the first one, Allah asks him, why are you stopping and turning back? And the man will say, Ya Allah, I'm hoping that you might forgive me before I enter the hellfire. And so Allah forgives him. And the one who goes running towards the hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks him, why are you running to hellfire? And he will say, oh Allah, In my life, I did not obey your commands, and now you have commanded me to enter the hellfire, and I want nothing but to obey what you have commanded me to do. And so again, the mercy and the forgiveness of Allah envelops this man. We read things from the ahadith, such as when the Prophet ﷺ asked one of his companions, he said to him, "Do you know what the right of Allah is upon you?" And the answer is, "Allah and His Messenger know best." He said, "The right of Allah upon you is that you obey Him, you worship Him, ascribing no partners to Him whatsoever." "And do you know," he continued, "what your right is upon Allah?" And the answer was, "Allah and His Messenger know best." So the answer that he gave the Prophet ﷺ, he said, "The right that you have upon Allah is that if you worship Him, ascribing no partners unto Him, He will not punish you." This is a guarantee which is given to us by Allah and His Messenger of forgiveness and a great reward. Forgiveness regardless of the level of sinning that a person may do. And we have also heard from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that 70,000 of his ummah will enter paradise without any reckoning whatsoever, without suffering whatsoever, on a day when many people will be suffering tremendous fear and tremendous anxiety awaiting their judgment. And 70,000 is actually a very small number. And then the Prophet gave us the good news that for every 1,000 of the 70,000, another 70,000, Allah will enter into paradise without reckoning. And then he said, and when he said this last thing, Umar ibn al-Khattab cried out, "Allahu Akbar," that Allah would take three handfuls of his hand, three handfuls of people, believers as well, and enter them as well. So the forgiveness, the mercy of Allah extends so great, so far. The Prophet ﷺ is recorded as saying, "If the unbelievers knew the extent of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even they would not give up, they would not despair on entering paradise, the possibility that they would be forgiven and enter paradise." As we read in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Qul ya ibadi alladhina asrafu ala anfusihim la taqnatu min rahmatillah inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'an innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. Say, O my servants, those of you who have oppressed your souls with wrongdoing, do not," and this is a command of Allah, He doesn't allow us to do this, He's commanding us, "do not give up on the mercy of Allah. Truly Allah forgives all sins altogether. Innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. He is al-ghafur, He is ar-rahim." When we say Bismillah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, both Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim come from mercy. The difference is Ar-Rahman is 1% of Allah's mercy which He has placed on this earth, and by it which the mother has mercy on her child, and we forgive each other and we have mercy upon each other. And Ar-Rahim is the special mercy. The Christians would call it grace. The special mercy, 99 parts out of 100, of His mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He saves for the day of judgment for those to be forgiven by Him. Allah yaghfiru liman yasha wa yu'adhibu man yasha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "No one will enter Jannah by his deeds." The question came to him, "Ya Rasulullah, not even you?" And he said, "I will not enter Jannah unless the mercy of Allah is right here." And he placed his hand upon his head. So the question then becomes, who is granted this mercy of Allah, this grace of Allah on the Day of Judgment? Who is it that these great promises of tremendous mercy reaches? Is it the person who has fewer sins than another? Is it the person who has less sins? You know, we all come from different experiences and different backgrounds, and we all have different mentalities, and we all have different abilities, both psychological, intelligence-wise, and emotional as well. There are some of us who have gone through great hardships when they were young, and these great hardships that they went through has molded them and given them perhaps a handicap with regards to a person who may have had an easy life. Some of us have different intellectual capacities as well. Some people understand how to resolve their problems and their issues that they may have when they're being tested by Allah better than other people. So we all have varying capabilities. For one thing, we know because of our different temperaments and different abilities, this is why it is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can judge each individual. The key to our own success is not so much whether we are burdened with sins which are only a little, or we are struggling with sins which are great. Allah says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah to the degree of your ability. The difference between the one who receives the forgiveness and the one who does not is simply the difference of what is in the heart. What the person thinks about, what the person focuses on, what the person attempts to do, and what the person considers himself to be. Allah says in the Quran, إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهِ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Those on the Day of Judgment are fearful of their punishment, fearful of their accounting. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهِ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Except the one who comes to Allah with a sound heart. قَلْب سَلِيمٍ. Healthy, sound heart. Well, a healthy and sound heart knows, number one, what is priority. Not the dunya, but the akhirah. A healthy and sound heart is the one who is always thinking not just of his gains in the dunya, but will be thinking in his life, whatever level he's at, whatever he's struggling with, whatever issues he has. He may be a convert to Islam who is still struggling with sins that he had done, still struggling, and we all do struggle. But his focus is on the akhirah. A person with a sound and healthy heart is a person who is not arrogant. He is not the kind of person who is self-sufficient, thinking that, oh, I haven't done anything bad. The things that he's done bad, they're like small things that he doesn't really worry about. When he goes to pray, if he prays, he goes and he prays, assuming that Allah is going to accept it. Maybe he's busy, thinking he goes away. And there are a lot of us like this. They go away thinking, well, I prayed, so Allah must accept it. No. The person who has a sound and healthy heart is, as Allah mentions in the Quran, لا أقسم بيوم القيامة ولا أقسم بالنفس اللوامة. The person with a sound heart has a nafs al-lawwama, the soul that is self-reproaching, self-examining. The person with a sound and healthy heart is always considering the sins that he or she has committed, not to be small, no matter how small they are. To a believer with a sound, healthy heart, any sin and every sin, since he does not know what the command of Allah will be on the Day of Judgment regarding that sin, is something that is unresolved, something that cannot be forgotten, cannot go away. The person with a sound and healthy heart comes to prayer and he remembers Allah. He has khushur of Allah. As the Quran says, مَنْ خَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ. He who has that khushur of Allah, which is fear and awe and respect of Allah, and he comes with a heart that is munib, a heart that is repentant. And as the Prophet ﷺ said, truly in the body there is an organ. If it is sound and healthy, then the whole body is healthy. And if it is corrupt, then the whole body is corrupt. Truly that organ is the heart. So it matters how a person approaches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sound and healthy heart is the one that confesses to Allah its sinfulness. The one that is constantly humble before Allah, constantly remembering their shortcomings and asking Allah for forgiveness. And it is the asking of Allah for forgiveness, the making of tawbah and istighfar, which Allah accepts from everyone who does not ascribe partners to Him. There's a saying of the scholars from the past, a very beautiful saying. It says, there is no small sin with insisting upon doing that sin. If you got a small sin and you insist on doing it and you don't feel bad about it, you keep doing it, then it's not a small sin. In fact, it's a major sin. And there is no major sin with istighfar. And in this case, istighfar means a tawbah, repenting to Allah. And as we know, the Prophet ﷺ said that the essence or the heart, the most essential portion of tawbah, the most essential part of the various parts that you must fulfill for tawbah, is nadam, regret. So, the one who easily forgets his own shortcomings and forgets his sins is as the one mentioned in the Quran, who is more unjust than the one who is reminded of the signs of his Lord, and he turns away from the remembrance or the reminder, and he forgets what his own hands have sent on before him. The fact of the matter is that anyone who has a mustard seed's worth of kibr, arrogance, pride, in his heart will not enter Jannah. So the person who does not have this sense of kibr will constantly be remembering his sins, constantly be asking Allah for forgiveness for his sins. When the companion Hudhaifa, who was very good at keeping secrets, was the only companion of the Prophet who was told by the Messenger of Allah the names of the hypocrites in Medina so that he could watch their movements. And he told Hudhaifa, because Hudhaifa was very good at keeping secrets. Then another companion of the Prophet was so concerned, so worried about his own condition, that maybe he's one of those hypocrites. This is the heart of a true believer. They do not feel self-satisfied that I've done so many good things. Do not consider yourselves to be pure. But they worry themselves if they are falling into nifaq, or if they have committed a sin which Allah does not forgive. And so this companion came to Hudhaifa and he asked him one question. He said to him, am I on that list? Am I one of those hypocrites? Hudhaifa did not say yes or no. He simply answered him. He said to him, do you pray when you're alone? And the man said, yes. He said, do you feel bad for your sins? And the man said, yes. And so Hudhaifa said, then good news for you. You are not on that list. You are not one of those people. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ مِنْ سَائِرُ الذُّنُوبِ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ